everybody. Aloha and welcome to this Cover 2 presentation of Hawaii football, past, present, and future. I'm Rob DeMello.
And I'm Sam Spangler. Over the next half hour, we'll catch up with four faces of island football. Retired six-time Pro Bowler Olin Kreutz, 808 transplant Seahawks two-time Pro Bowler Michael Bennett, Saints linebacker Haole Kikaha, and Alabama freshman QB Tua Tagovailoa.
Now, recently, the Polynesian Football Hall of Fame inducted its class of 2017, with three from Hawaii being enshrined at the Polynesian Cultural Center. Mililani grad, two-time Super Bowl champion Ma'a Tanuvasa, Kahuku alum, 11-year NFL veteran Chris Naiole, and fellow former Red Raiders CFL All-Star Junior Ayu.
Which now makes 15 Hawaii-born or raised football legends immortalized in La'ie. Now, part of the very first class was three-time Prep Bowl champion Olin Kreutz. The St. Louis graduate was an All-American at Washington before becoming a two-time All-Pro and six-time Pro Bowler with the Chicago Bears. Recently, he sat down with Rob at a place close to his heart, the Crusaders' weight room.
Can't lie, man, we win it.
We're here at your alma mater. When you think back to being a student here walking these halls, was Pro Football Hall of Fame nominee ever anywhere in that dream, or was that even just too far-fetched?
No, I love football. You know, I always loved it. I loved playing it, but no, I wasn't thinking that big. I was thinking about the Prep Bowl and winning a job, just trying to win a job on a great St. Louis team was what I was thinking about. So to think that I'd be in the NFL and have that kind of career and to even be considered for the Hall of Fame, no, that would have been a pipe dream.
When you think about that honor that you received, you know, just a few months ago, as far as being nominated for the Pro Football Hall of Fame, I mean, what does that mean to you? Because when you really look at it, especially from your position, because there's no statistics directly associated to you, so you got to think about, you know, I'm being honored in that way just purely based on respect.
Yeah, it's mind-boggling. Like you can't even wrap your mind around it, because it's almost when you hear it. I remember my agent texted me and he said, "Congratulations," and I said, "For what?" And he said, "You got nominated to the Pro Football Hall of Fame." And I thought he was, you know, we mess with each other, joke around. So I thought he was joking. So I didn't even think about it. And then the more I got text and, you know, you look online, and it's just humbling, because that's the first feeling you have, is like to get mentioned with those guys, the greatest to ever play the game. And you don't even know if you're ever really going in or not. But just to be nominated or even considered was a humbling experience for me, because I have so much respect for the game, because it gave me everything I have.
Your love for football is obvious. I mean, I see it when you're working with kids. Definitely saw it when you played the game. So with that being said, how difficult was it to kind of come to that realization of that day that, you know what, my football career is over. This is it for me. I've done enough.
It's difficult, I think, coming up into it, where you start to, like, lose a step, because, you know, Father Time is undefeated, right? And we all start to feel it, where you're not doing the same weights in the weight room anymore. You're not as quick as you used to be. You're not as fast. Now you're running through these big guys, and it really hurts. So when the time came for me to decide it was over, that wasn't really hard. I guess because I played long enough, right? So I was at the Chicago Bear camp this year with a couple of my friends, and I watched their practice, and I looked at somebody and said, "I really used to do that? Like, that's insane. That's crazy." It's a tough game. It's a tough game, and it's a young man's game. So when your time is up, it's up.
When football ended, what became the hardest part about being a former offensive lineman?
Yes, because when you're an offensive lineman, I mean, you sit down some days and you eat 10,000 calories, because, you know, your job is to be big and heavy. So just to change your life and try to bring your weight down and live a normal life where it's not like a car crash every day. Because, you know, some guys, you need that. You need to go out there and hit things and hit people, and just to transition into a normal life. You're not going to be in a locker room every day. And maybe I can't swear at you every day. You can't swear at people in normal life like you do in the locker room. So those are the little things you miss sometimes. And, you know, you're never going to run out of a tunnel in front of 80,000 people and have planes flying over your head again. I mean, that's a feeling you can't explain to people.
I know that people from Hawaii are a little more modest, so is the attention even more annoying for you?
I wouldn't say I'm enjoying this, no.
There is no mystery at all that when you were playing, wasn't a big fan of the media, wasn't a big fan of having to do interviews and all that. So if I told you 10 years ago that there would be a day that you would be a media member in Chicago, being an analyst for the Bears, how quickly would it take before you slapped me and told me I was absolutely nuts?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's just when you're on a team, like anybody who's played football, they know sometimes the media can be your worst enemy. So understanding that the media can tear your team apart, you try to stay away from talking on camera and those kind of things. And I remember they came to me and to talk to me about being a part of post-game, the radio show in Chicago. And I didn't even want to do it then because you just kind of feel like you're still part of this football. But like you were talking about earlier, the transition out of the locker room and all that stuff. And it kind of keeps you close to the game. I enjoy it now. I enjoy talking about the team and talking about what you see and what you don't see. But you're right. I had no use for the media when I played.
Obviously, you're a guy that, you know, carried the flag for the 808 for so long in pro football. And now that you're gone, so many other guys are doing it. How much did football help you appreciate where you're from because you're representing it the way you were?
What you learn very quickly when you leave, and I went back to the University of Washington, is that it doesn't matter what school everybody goes to, we're all from Hawaii, and we're all going to take care of each other. And you realize you're representing the state and you're representing an island of people with a lot of pride.
When you look at Polynesian football today, with the Polynesian Bowl, with the Polynesian Hall of Fame, with first-round draft picks, with guys being nominated for the Hall of Fame, how impressed are you and how much pride do you hold for these people that are representing its people?
Man, like you know, football is king in Hawaii. So we've always known there's really, really, really good Polynesian football players because Polynesian people are family-oriented, you know, like a good, clean fight, and they're perfect for football. They're perfect for a team game. So not shocked that these kids have come a long way, and the Polynesian community has come a big part of football. Just took those guys a little while to figure out that, you know, we could be a huge asset to them.